أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين أما بعد فقد قال الله عز وجل في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد قل هو الله أحد أمنت بالله صدق الله العظيم وبلغنا رسوله النبي الكريم الأمين أما بعد فقد قال الله عز وجل في شأن حبيبه صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم مخبرا وآمرا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصل عليه الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك وسلم عليك يا حبيب الله. Continuing on from the lesson which we left off last, which was the opening chapter of the Fiqh Al-Akbar of Imam Al-Azm Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man ibn Thabit radiyallahu ta'ala an, in which we spoke about the core foundations of our belief, and the ultimate one was the oneness, monotheism, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the oneness of Allah Almighty. Then he moved on from there, and as mentioned here, أصل التوحيد وما يصح الاعتقاد عليه يجب أن يقول آمنت بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله والبعث بعد الموت والقدر خيره وشره من الله تعالى والحساب والميزان والجنة والنار وذلك كله حق. That what are the fundamental points, certain articles of our faith which we must believe in order for us to be recognized as a Muslim, in order for us to be recognized as a believer. And we spoke about Allah and His qualities, His attributes. Then we spoke about the angels, that what were the main angels, what sort of belief we should have in relation to angels. And we mentioned some of the names of the main angels and their duties also. Then we spoke about the divine revelations, books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which they have, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed upon His chosen messengers, and He gave them these revelations and a way of life to give to the people, which they came to guide. And this is what distinguished them, a Rusul, from the Anbiya, the messengers from the prophets. That every Rusul, every messenger is a Nabi, is a prophet, but every Nabi is not a Rusul. Because what distinguishes the two of them is that a Nabi is one who has been sent to guide humanity, to guide people, but a Rasul is that Nabi who has come and has been given a divine revelation also, a set of rules, a scripture to come and use that as a form of guidance. That's what distinguishes the two. And indeed, the Rasul, the messengers, have a higher rank and higher status than the Anbiya. Then amongst the Rasul, there are different statuses. Then the Ulul Adam Rasuls, meaning the most highest rank of Rasul, are the four which I mentioned to you last time. And then amongst them, of course, we know that the Imam of all the Anbiya and Rusul, the leader of all the Anbiya and Rusul, the master of all the prophets, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, who was sent as a final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the chain of prophethood ended with the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala sallam, and after him there will be no Nabi or no Rasul, as the Quran mentions very clearly that we have sent you, O Prophet sallallahu ta'ala sallam, and we have made you Khatamun Nabiyyin, we have made you the seal, the final of all prophets. Whereas at the first part of the ayah of the Holy Quran it mentions مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَحَدٍ مِّن رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَاكِمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ, that he is a messenger of Allah, he is a messenger of Allah, O Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, indeed that you are not the father of any one of these, you are not a father of anyone, but you are the messenger of Allah, and you are Khatam al-Nabiyyin, you are the seal of all prophets, seal of all the Anbiya. Reason why Nabi was used here, because if you were said Khatam al-Rusul, the seal of all messengers, somebody could say that no Rusul will come, but a Nabi can come. Therefore here the Quran mentions that the Khatam al-Nabiyyin, the seal of all Anbiya, meaning when a Nabi cannot come, then there is no possibility for a Rusul to come. Because the first stage is to be a Nabi, then when revelation is given to him, in the sense that he is given a divine revelation, a book to go and guide, uses a form of guidance for his people, then he becomes a Rasul. So here, by mentioning here that the Prophet must be sent as a final seal of all Anbiya, after him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no Nabi will come and no Rasul will come. So we spoke about the divine books, then we spoke about the messengers and the Anbiya, that how many of Allah's prophets have come to this world, and out of them, how many were Anbiya and how many were messengers. And we do speak on this, that what made them distinguished, like I mentioned already, and I will go into more detail now, that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, amongst all of his Anbiya, the narration which comes in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, we know is a great muhaddith and imam, that when he was mentioned to them, when they mention and they narrate a narration of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he was asked that, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that how many prophets of Allah have come to this world? Now, two different narrations have come in particular. One is of 170,000 prophets, but the most common one is 124,000 Anbiya have come to this world. 124,000 have come to this world. Some scholars have written that we should not emphasize the number too much, because why? If we limitize it to 124,000, then maybe it is out of our knowledge that more may have come, but then we are not including them into the seal of prophethood. Then that we will become wrong in that sense. Therefore, we should not emphasize too much, but in brief, what the point that is mentioned in the narration is that, from what we learned from the narrations, is that the most common narration which has come is 124,000 prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have come to this world. Then further on, وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُولِهِ وَالْبَعْثِ بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ, the next article of faith which we must believe in after these, Allah, His angels, His divine books, all His messages and prophets, is وَالْبَعْثِ بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ, which is coming to life after death. So this is the next point which you should make a note of, that life after death. So once death has come upon us in this world, then we must believe that after this death which has come upon us, once again we will be given life, what they call resurrection after death. Resurrection after death, in simple words, is that when we leave this world and we are buried, however we may be, we have left this world, death has come upon us. The Quran mentions that every soul shall taste death. After this death has come upon us, resurrection means where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala collects the body parts of that person, brings them together, and then the soul is put back into that body and he is resurrected back to life again. That, in simple words, what the meaning of this article is for us to believe in, that no matter how, some people are fortunate enough to have a grave, others are not. Some people, the bodies are not recovered. Some people who, someone may say that, does that mean that those people who are cremated, that those who are burnt after the death, even will they be resurrected as well? Allah will collect their ashes and their body parts as well, bring them back together and put the soul into them as well and resurrect them as well. Resurrect them as well after death. So this resurrection after death, life after death, is a compulsory article for every one of us to believe in order for our faith to be complete. So this is the next article of faith, which is some people, however, this also came amongst the early times of some of the misguided sects of Tanasukh, that they had this belief, like how is mentioned today, like when a person dies, then his soul gets transmitted to something else and he comes back in the form of something else. This, however, is against the teachings of Islam and against the teaching of our Aqida. Our belief is very simple, that when a person dies and he leaves this world, however his body is, however it may be, thousands of years later, millions of years later, but when the time comes for him to be resurrected, Allah will collect his body parts and then the soul will be put back into that person and he will be resurrected again after he has died. So that is the next part which we must believe in as Muslims for our deen to be complete. The next point which mentioned here, وَالْقَدَرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, we must believe in Qadr. Qadr is the next point which we must believe in, which is destiny, and that all good and bad is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the next article of faith which needs to be noted, is that all good and all bad has been destined for us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is another article of faith which we must believe in. After these is all good and bad, qadrihi, khayrihi wa sharrihi min Allah ta'ala. All good and bad is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in relation to this, that it is narrated by once Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, that they were having a discussion amongst themselves in relation to destiny. And Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an, he had this view that good came from Allah, but evil came from a person, from himself. It came from within yourself. So meaning good Allah gives and bestows upon his creation, but evil is generated and formed from a person himself. This is the view that Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu had. Then in opposition to this, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who again we know the two most superior people after the Anbiya to step on this earth, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar, and the two most educated as well. So now they are having an intellectual dialogue with one another on this issue, that is good must be from Allah and evil would be from a person himself. Whereas Hazrat Umar held the view that good and evil both is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So obviously in the discussion they needed for it to be decided. So they went to the person who held the keys to all knowledge, and that was the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they came to the majesty of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they asked this question that in relation to this, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied and said that amongst all of Allah's creation, Adi should make a note of this as we'll be going along with this narration as well, between Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala. So it's upon the article which we are speaking about, which is all good and bad is from Allah. So this is our belief. Now where is this derived from? So the article is that all good and bad is from Allah. That's the point which we must be discussing now. Then from there, we're looking at now that where has this been derived from? Where do we receive this belief from? As the Quran mentions, but in one narration which I mentioned to you here now, is this narration of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, that where they were discussing this point, that does good only come from Allah and evil from a person himself, or is both? Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq had the view that good is from Allah and evil is from a person himself, whereas Hazrat Umar had the view that good and evil is both from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then they went to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they asked this question to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that what is the decision in relation to this? And the Prophet replied that the first amongst Allah's own creation to speak upon this issue, which used to us speaking about today, the first to speak and discuss this issue were Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam and Hazrat Mikael. That these are the two angels of Allah. They had this discussion amongst themselves as well, that they were confused. One had the view that Allah, only good is from Allah, evil is not from Allah. One had the view that both evil and good, both is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Jibreel had the same view as Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Jibreel had the view that only good only comes from Allah, evil does not come from Allah. And Hazrat Mikael had the view that Hazrat Umar had, that good and evil both is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at that time the Prophet said that, Ya Abu Bakr, that on this issue Umar is right, that good and evil both comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in this issue, Mikael alayhi salam, the angel of Allah amongst the four great angels, him and Hazrat Umar shared the same view. Them two are right in this issue, that all good and evil both is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then further on, the Messenger said that if evil was to come from a person himself only, then Allah would not have created Iblis. Iblis is the, which we call in common terms, the devil, who comes and he is the one that makes a person commit sin through waswasa, to different whispers and so on and so forth. And Allah is the one who created him. So if evil was not to come from Allah, then Allah would not have created Iblis. So the fact that Allah created Iblis, what the reasons are different, but this clearly shows a point from this narration that good and evil both comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the next article of faith for us that we must believe in after all these other things are, is that good and evil both is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just make a note of that and jot that down in your own words, in that however you think is easy for you to understand. Then we come on to the point here that which mentions that wal hisabi wal mizan wal jannati wal nari dhalika kullu haqqun. That hisab is the calculation, literally meaning hisab, meaning that on the day of judgment we will be held accountable. We will be held accountable for the sins and the deeds that we have done in our life. So this thing of hisab, of calculating and being accountable for the sins and the good and bad that we have done in our life, this is something which you must believe in. The other thing is mizan. Mizan is the scale. Mizan literally means scale. The scale in which our these deeds are good and bad will be weighed. Now how the scale looks, how it is, what it seems like, how it feels like, we cannot explain that. How? All we know is that it exists. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has designed a way for us to be accounted for our deeds, and then He has made this procedure of mizan, which is a scale in which our good and bad deeds will be weighed to see which is the more, and that is the way how we will be made accountable for what we have done. The next point, wal jannah, paradise, wal nar, and the hellfire, both. وَذَلِكَ كُلُّهُ حَقٌ. That all of these, meaning the mizan, the hisab, the mizan, jannah and nar. So these four things you have to make a note of. First is hisab, which is accountability for the deeds which we have done. The second is mizan. Mizan is the scale which will be used to for our sins to be weighed according to. Number three is jannah, which is paradise. And an-nar, which is the fire. These all four things we must believe in, that these are true. That, and it all works in a way that how it has been mentioned, that, and coming out to this, as a Mullah Al-Qadri mentions the point here as well, from the point, the beginning, that first thing Allah has mentioned is amantu billah, that we must say that we believe in Allah, wa malaikatihi, and we must believe in all His angels, wa kutubihi, and we must believe in His divine revelations, books. وَرُسُولِهِ and all His messengers. Why is it that this order has been established? Why shouldn't it be that we must believe in Allah, then the Rasuls should have been mentioned, then the books should have been mentioned, then the angels should have been mentioned? Why are the angels mentioned straight after Allah and before His messengers, before the books as well? So they mention this. The reason why this it has been categorized in this way is that Allah is the Lord. Allah is the Lord, and He chose His messengers. So He mentioned the chose His angels, which is the second game of duty. For what reason? Then kutubihi, to take these books and give them to His Rasul. So this is why this order has been mentioned. The first Allah is the one who spoke, and though like the Quran or other books, then He gave this to His angels. The book. Then they went and took this and gave it to the messengers. So therefore the angels have come before the books and come before the messengers, because they are the ones who have taken this and transmitted this from Allah to the messengers. Then after this, then why has it been mentioned that the hisab, the mizan, jannah and nar, these four things? Hisab is the accountability. Mizan is the way in which we are being accounted. So the first point is that no matter what we do in our life, good or bad, we'll be accountable for it. Me and you, every single person who has become mature, he will be accountable for what he done in his life, good or bad. If he has done good, that will be placed upon the mizan as well, upon the scale. And the bad he has done, that will also be placed upon the scale. Then according to that, whatever weighs more, that will determine whether he goes to paradise or whether he goes to the hellfire. So this is the procedure which Allah has made for me and you and for every person, that his deeds shall be weighed upon the scale, and then according to that he will be given his reward, either which is paradise if his good deeds are more, And if not, then he will be given the hellfire. But to believe in all these, to believe in the hisab, to believe in the mizan, to believe in Jannah and to believe in Nar, these four terminologies, these four things, it is all haq, and we must believe in all of these in order for our faith to be complete. So these four things, make note of that as well. Hisab, mizan, Jannah and Nar. Hisab, mizan, Jannah and Nar. So this is the first chapter, it has been completed now. The first chapter in relation to what are those things, the asr al-tawheed, the root, the real foundation of our tawheed, of our belief, oneness in Allah, that has been completed now. The first chapter, which Imam Sahib mentions here, now they bring up the second chapter, which refers to the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And though I've mentioned this in the beginning as well, in the last chapter when I spoke about Allah, but again they are mentioned in the text, so we'll go through them in this sense as well. And the characteristics of Allah, attributes, have been divided into two. And I'll explain that to you now when the time comes, that how they've been divided into two. So first they begin, وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَاحِدًا لَا مِن تَرِيكٍ عَدَدِي وَلَاكِ مِن تَرِيكٍ أَنَّهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُلَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. That Allah Ta'ala, the Most High, Allah the Most High, Wahid, He is one. He is one. Allah is one. But how? لَا مِن تَرِيكٍ عَدَدِي. لَا مِن تَرِيكٍ عَدَدِ. Not in the terms of a number. So Allah is not one in the term of a number. How we have number one, number two, number three. But in what sense? Walakin, but min tariqi annahu la sharika lahu. But in the term that He has no comparison. Allah is one, not in the term used as in a number. Because why? When you say number one can be half of two. Number one is half of two, is a third of three, is a quarter of four. So if we refer to Allah as a number, then mazallah al-ayaz billah, then that can mean something else as well. Same thing, if we have Allah as a number, as number one, you have number one, then you have number two, then number three, then number four. You compare that whoever comes number one, he's number two, he's number three. But we do not refer to Allah as one as in a number, but we refer to Allah as one, the how He is that unique that He has no comparison at all. In everything which Allah has, everything which Allah has in His attributes, in every way or form, Allah is one, as in the sense that there is nothing like Him. Like the Quran mentions here, لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُلَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. That He neither begets, nor has He begotten. Allah has no parents, He has no children, and there is nothing like Him. There is nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the way that the belief we should have in Allah. When we say Allah is one, that's the way that we should believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be one. Carrying on from this, لا يشبه شيئا من الأشياء من خلقه. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not similar to anything from His creation. That Allah is not similar to anything from His creation. So from amongst His creation, whatever Allah has created, in no way or no form or in any way possible is Allah similar to anything which He has created. That's not possible. Then moving on from this, and same vice versa to this, مِنْ خَلْقِهِ وَلَا يُشْبِهُهُ شَيْءٌ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ. And nothing from His creation is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is not like anything from His creation, and nothing from His creation is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This diminishes the point that some people have said, like the, for example, the belief of the Christians and the Jews, the Yahud and Nasara, that had the belief that Jesus alayhi salam, is the Isa alayhi salam, or is the Uzair alayhi salam, who the Jews believe to be the Son of God, and Isa alayhi salam, how the Christians believe Jesus to be the Son of God. But they actually believe these to be a form of God. Though it is a creation of Allah, but they believe them to be a form of God. Whereas we say that nothing from Allah's creation is like Him. And just like that, they say Jesus is God. Oh Lord, Lord Jesus, they say, Allah Azza wa Jalla. Nothing from Allah's creation can be like Him. Both ways, it is not possible, for Allah isn't like His creation. Nothing from Allah's creation is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's something as well which we must believe in any way or form. And then he mentions, لَمْ يَزَلْ وَلَا يَزَالُ بِأَسْمَائِهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ وَذَاتِيَةِ وَالْفِعْلِيَةِ. Okay, now we're coming to the point that of how the attributes of Allah are divided. Yes, how it says here, لَمْ يَزَلْ وَلَا يَزَالُ بِأَسْمَائِهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ. He was, He is, and forever will be the possessor of all His attributes. He was, is, and forever will be the possessor of His attributes. Now, this is something which, how would this make sense? In the sense that, for example, now, when there was nothing except Allah, was Allah the creator at that time? When there was nothing created at all, when there was nothing created at all, was Allah the creator at that time? Allah was the creator at that time. So meaning Allah was the creator when there was no creation. This is one example. Allah was the creator when there was...
When you say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be there when everything is like destroyed, what does that refer to? Because when we are resurrected after our death, how could we not like...
No, of course, when you say here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our belief is that Allah was there when there was nothing, and when there will be nothing, Allah will still be there. When we say, for example, now a human being, we know that he will die, will come out of life again. Does that mean that, how then, there's still something that's still being there, whilst Allah is there as well? When we say, for example, now, when we come after we have died, we come out of life again, Allah has promised us that we will stay alive. When we are in paradise, wherever we are, we will stay alive forever. But that is Allah's guarantee upon us. Allah has bestowed that upon us. Within ourselves, we have a possibility that we can be ended at any time. Whereas for Allah, it is la mahal. It is not possible to even think or to in any way or form that Allah can have an end even. Whereas for us, the possibility is there that there can be an end for us. There will be an end to certain things of us. Certain things will be finished. Like for example, the earth or the other creations of Allah, that they will have an end and they will be destroyed forever. Us, we will die, we will come back to life again. But the fact that we have died and come back to life again, this also shows as well that there has been an end for us and a beginning again. But the end and the beginning is there, whereas Allah is free from beginning and end. So that's how that explains. When the fact that we die and then resurrected again, this shows that you were at once, then you ended, then now you have started again. Whereas Allah is free from any beginning and He is free from any end. That is the difference between Allah and His creation, in the sense that then, so Allah was, is, and forever will be the possessor of all His attributes. So whatever attribute you refer to Allah, this does not mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is necessary, for example, like me and you, until we do not receive knowledge, we cannot be a alim. We cannot know until there's no knowledge for us to know. Until we do not create something, we cannot be called a creator. Until we do not speak, we cannot be called the speaker. Whereas all of Allah's attributes, even before Allah created, He was the creator. That attribute of creator was always there. Before Allah spoke to Musa, before there was anything for Allah to speak to, Allah was still the one who spoke. Allah was the speaker. Before there was anything to hear, Allah was still the all-hearing. Before there was anything to see, Allah was the all-seeing. So Allah was, is, and forever will be. Just like that, when there will be no one to speak to, Allah will still be the one speaking one. When there will be nothing to see, Allah will still be the all-seeing. When there will be nothing to create, Allah will still be the creator. So Allah was, is, and forever will be the possessor of all His attributes. And nothing needs to happen in order for Allah to receive that attribute. Because Allah possessed that attribute before anything even happened. So that's the belief we must have about Allah, that Allah's attributes, He was always the possessor and is the possessor and always will be the possessor of all His attributes. Moving on from there.
Just quickly, you know, the last point said Allah is not similar to His creation and nothing is like Him from the creation. So is that, where did he, in that statement, is that from the Quran or is that the Aqida?
No, obviously this Aqida, the point here is, come from the Quran, Laysaka Misri Shem. Laysaka Misri Shem. Nothing at all can be compared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a verse of the Holy Quran. And also, this word which you say, oneness of Allah, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. Nothing is to like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is like Allah. Like, the word like here means to compare. For example, I say, so and so looks like this. Like is a word to compare. The must, you can either use the liking can be either metaphorical or literal. If you say he is like a lion, that means his bravery is being compared to a lion's bravery. If I say something literally, that's also the word liking is being used to compare. But when there is nothing suitable to be compared to Allah, therefore nothing amongst Allah's creation is like Allah, and Allah is like nothing from His creation. That clears the point there, and the Quran clarifies that for us, that there is nothing which can be compared to Allah, and Allah cannot be compared to anything, because Allah is the creator of all His creation, and when there is only Allah, other than creation, is only one God. The Quran mentions that if there were two gods, then the world would not run. One would say, I want the sun to rise, the other would say, I want the sun to set. One would say, I want this, the other would say, I want that. Would not work. That's why we believe in one. One Allah, one Lord, the one who controls everything. And everything which He controls, everything which He sustains for, everything which He gives to, is His creation. Is His creation. It is what He has created. And from His creation, there is nothing like the Creator. And the Creator is nothing like His creation. That's a simple belief, in simple words, what our belief should be in relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and then, okay, so further on now, it mentions here that وَصِفَاتِهِ وَذَاتِيَةِ وَالْفِعْلِيَةِ, and the attributes, a possessor of His, so Allah's possessor was, is of His, of all His attributes, which attributes? His essential, so essential is the first type of attributes, and وَذَاتِيَةِ وَصِفَاتِيَةِ, first is essential, and then active attributes.
Essential,
His essential and active attributes. These are the two type of attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Essential and
active. So, zatiya, it refers to Allah's essential attributes, zatiya, and fi'liya refers to Allah's active attributes. So, zatiya and fi'liya. So now we're going to dwell into some of Allah's essential and some of Allah's active attributes. Wa amma zatiyatu falhayatu walqudratu walilmu walkalamu walsam'u walbasar walirada. So these are the mentioning some of the essential attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And first, so they're now giving a list of some of the essential attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as for the essential attributes of Allah, first is what? Al-hayatu. They are life. Life. Wal-qudratu, power. So life, power. You can even make a note of these, the Arabic words, where Hayat is for life, Qudra is for power. You got Hayat, you got Qudra, Ilm is knowledge. Wal Kalam, which is speech. Kalam is speech. Was Sam'a is hearing. Sama'at, hearing. Wal-basar, seeing. Wal-irada, irada, willing. So you've got Hayat is life, Qudra is power, Ilm is knowledge, Kalam is speech, Sam' is hearing, Basar is seeing, and Irada is willing. So these are amongst Allah's essential attributes. وَعَمَّ الْفِعْلِيَّةُ And Allah's active attributes are فَالتَّخْلِيقُ Creating.
What was that, Abdul?
Allah's active attributes are takhliq, creating, watarziq, sustaining. So sustaining meaning give me sustenance, give me rizq, tarziq. Wal insha'u wal ibda'u. So wal insha means bringing into being. Bringing something into being. That's insha. Wal ibda. To originate something. Was sun means to make, making. So here the fi'liya, we have takhliq, which is creating, tarziq, which is sustaining. So meaning what Allah has created, then He sustains, He gives sustenance to that creation as well. So Allah is the creator, then tarziq, to give sustenance, wal insha, to bring something into being, something which was not there, to bring that into being. Wal ibda, ibda means ibtida, beginning, to originate something, meaning something which was not there, now Allah has originated that. So meaning Allah is, in reality, Allah is the originator of everything. Because when nothing was there, and then when Allah brought that into being, that means Allah originated it. So Allah is the originator of everything. So ibda wa sun, to make things, making things. Wa ghayru dhalika min sifat al-fi'l. And other than this, which are from amongst the active attributes. So these are the main highlighted ones which have been mentioned. So now again, bringing back to the same point, لَمْ يَزَلْ وَلَا يَزَالُ بِإِسْمَائِهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ وَلَمْ يَحْدُثْ لَهُ إِسْمٌ وَلَا صِفَةٌ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was always the possessor of His names, the all-powerful, the creator, the sustainer, the giver, the originator. Now somebody might bring the point up here again, that when there was nothing that was created, was Allah the creator then? When there was nothing to give sustenance to, was Allah the sustainer then? When nothing was originated, was Allah the originator then? When nothing was made, was Allah the maker then? When nothing was in being, was Allah still the one who brings things into being? The answer is yes. Because Allah was always the possessor of His attributes and of His names, and nothing needed to happen in order for Allah to receive that attribute. Nothing needed to happen in order for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to receive that attribute. So that's the points which... So do you want to go over the mention the points again for the benefit of the brothers? The essential and active attributes.
So the essential dhaathiyya attributes, al-hayat, life, al-qudra, power, al-ilm, knowledge, al-kalam, speech, as-sam, hearing, al-basar, seeing, al-irada, willing. We have the fi'liya active attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is creating, takhliq, sustaining, tarziq, bringing to being, insha, originating, ibda, making, sunnah, and there are others.
So basically that's what highlighted the main attributes of Allah, which are His essential attributes, which are, so what's the word for essential attributes? Zatiyya. And for His active attributes? Fi'liyya. So it comes from Zat and Fi'l. Zat means His essence, Fi'l means action. So Allah's essential attributes and Allah's active attributes. Wa Allah in action, wa are performed, creating, sustaining, so on and so forth. So further on, Imam Sahib mentions that in relation to this point, carrying on, لم يزل عالما بعلمه والعلم صفة في الأزل. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was forever the all-knowing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was forever being the all-knowing with his knowledge. And knowledge was an attribute of Allah in pre-eternity. So Allah was always the one, the all-knowing. Allah was always the all-knowing with his knowledge. Before pre-eternity was an attribute of Allah was all-knowing. Why? Well, again, it comes back to the same point again, that even before there was no knowledge, when there was nothing there to know, Allah's mother was still the all-knowing. And that was an attribute of Allah, which was there before, pre-eternity, before. Just like that, he was the speaker with his speech, and speech was an attribute before pre-eternity. And just like this, creating, and he was the doer. So all these attributes of Allah, in brief, knowledge of experience again and again, and Imam was mentioning it here again, that all of Allah's attributes, they were there in pre-eternity. So before anything actually happened, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was still the possessor of these attributes with his knowledge, with his creatorship. Yes?
You know, when you say speech and hearing and these sort of attributes, are they sort of like, you know, the way we like listen and speak and hear, is it different from that?
It's different to that because why? One major difference is that our speech, our hearing, our seeing is all created. Whereas Allah's speech, hearing and seeing is not created. This is the difference. So this is exactly when the next chapter comes on to in relation to the Quran, whether the Quran is a speech of Allah or whether it's a creation of Allah. And in that this thing comes more in more detail is mentioned that where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's seeing, hearing, these are not created, but they are created for us. And Allah's hearing, seeing cannot be explained. His speaking cannot be explained. No language can be given. Now what language was it that was spoken in? How is it spoken? What way was it spoken? What was the voice? What was the sound? The letters we use, is that the same letters? It can't be compared. Because why? The letters we use are created. The languages we use are created. The speech we use is created. Whereas Allah is free from that. And He cannot be comparable to anything from His creation. So all we know is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa. He spoke to Musa, and we believe that He spoke to Musa. And we believe Musa alayhi salam heard Allah as well. But how, in what way, that's not for us to try to dwell into. We cannot give a language to Allah, we cannot give an alphabet to Allah. How our language is all bound by certain things which have been created by an alphabet, by letters, by makharij, and so on and so forth.
So you just said about the language, the Quran is in Arabic. You say the Quran is the words of Allah subhanahu
wa ta'ala. See, the Arabic, again, Arabic is a language which has been formed here. Now we know that the language of paradise would be Arabic, and that's the language we will speak in. But then how this language of Arabic has been bound and been made a language, in what way? That this is the alphabet, this is the rules, this is the grammar, so and so forth. That's been created and made by us. That cannot apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In that sense, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bound by that same Arabic that we know and we learn here today. That cannot be the case. But whatever the Quran, for example, now, that's why we say the Quran is that miracle of the Prophet and that speech of Allah that till today, thousands of years have passed, but no one can still say that I have conquered all the knowledge of the Quran. This is not possible. Because if we were to encompass all of it, then that would drop the point that is the speech of Allah. Because Allah's quality, one of Allah's attributes is His speech. And that cannot be comprehended by mankind. That cannot be comprehended by His creation. So the Arabic which we have today, that Arabic cannot be applied to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And moving on further from there, that again, all the actions of Allah, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the doer, for example. Now, what He does, and as a result, is a creation. But Allah's doing itself is not a creation. So for example, now this is, I've done something, this is the result of that. That's a creation, and what I have just done, this is also a creation. Whereas for Allah, His actions, whatever He does, His fi'l, His attributes, none of that is a creation. It's free from any sort of creation in any way or form. So that is not a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah speaks, His speech is not a creation. It's the speech of Allah, the attribute of Allah. And it was always there even before anything was created. Before there was anything to speak to, Allah at that time also possessed this quality and will always possess this quality of speech, of knowledge, of doing, of making, of originating, so on and so forth. So this is a brief, now we move on a bit. So it's not the same thing again and again, because I've mentioned it a few times now in relation to that. So in basic, that's the what we must believe in Allah. So the if you can explain to the brothers that what do we mean by that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His qualities, how would you explain to somebody who asked you that these qualities of Allah, attributes of Allah, that you say Allah is the creator, Allah is the one who speaks, Allah is the one all knowledge of everything, when nothing existed, did that still apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How would you explain it? Do you give him a hand? How would you explain that if somebody asked you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when there was nothing there, was He still the creator?
Is it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is and always will be the possessor of His attributes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, carry on.
The specific term for that.
No, basically, what you said, that's exactly right, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always is and was and will be the possessor of all His attributes, even when there was nothing there, He was. Because why, in simple words, why He has mentioned there, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing needed to come into being for in order for Him to be the one who made that. Nothing was needed to be spoken to in order for Him to be the speaker. Nothing was needed to be known in order for Him to be the knower. So even when there was nothing there, Allah always has, will and forever will be the possessor of all His attributes, whether they are active, whether they are essential. The simple was what we believe here. Now the next chapter we move on to, that's a short chapter in relation to some of the active and essential attributes. So again, so like what we mentioned earlier, the qualities of Allah, the rights towards Allah in relation to wujud, qidam, baqa, مُخَالَفَ لِلْحَوَادِثِ عِلْمِ so on so forth, that should be learnt as well. Then the articles of our faith, to believe in Allah, all His angels, to believe in all His books, all His messengers, to believe in the life after death, to believe in good and bad is all from Allah, to believe in the hisab, to believe in the mizan, the accountability, to believe in the scale, to believe in paradise, to believe in hell, that, and then moving on to Allah's dhaathiyya and fi'liyya sifat, Allah's essential and active attributes, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is a life, hayat, qudra, power, ilm, so on and so forth, and then His active attributes as well of takhliq, of tarziq, of ibda, of insha, of sun, of these attributes of Allah, active ones, they should be learnt as well. And you should know as well that every single attribute of Allah, Allah was always the possessor of that, even before there was anything there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was still the possessor of all the attributes, always was, always is, and always will be the possessor of all His names, beautiful names, and of all His attributes. Now we're moving on to the Quran. The Quran, Imam Sahib, next point we mentioned here, the Quran, the speech of Allah. So now we're speaking about the Quran, because firstly, what we must understand is that during the time in history, certain sects grew, especially the Mu'tazila, that believed that the Quran was a creation of Allah. The Quran was a creation of Allah. At that time, scholars wrote against this, they did jihad against this. One name which always comes to mind, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, radiallahu ta'ala an, who is also the master of the Hanbali madhab as well, and was also a Hafizul Hadith. Not only a Hafizul Hadith, but he was a Hakimul Hadith. Hakimul Hadith. And his students write that when Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal left this world, he was a hafiz. He had memorized over 1 million hadiths. Over 1 million narrations of the Prophet ﷺ, Imam Sahib was a hafiz of. A hafizul, you have a Shaykhul Hadith, which is a teacher of hadith. Then you have a Hafizul Hadith, which is a hafiz of 100,000 narrations. Then you have a hujjatul hadith, someone who's memorized over 300,000 narrations. Then you have a hakim al hadith, which has memorized 500,000 narrations, and no angle of hadith is hidden from him. Then imagine that there's nothing higher than that. Then Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal was that 500,000 is halfway, that they were a hafiz of over 1,000,000 hadiths. So can you see the rank of Imam Sahib? And they did jihad against this issue as well, of the whether the Quran was created or whether it's a speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam Sahib here mentions also what our belief as the Ahl Sunnah should be in relation to the belief about the Quran, that whether the Quran was a creation of Allah or whether it is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Sahib mentions.
So is this a quote of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal?
No, this is Imam Abu Hanifa. This is the Fiqh Al-Akbar. I just mentioned Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, that not only the Hanfis did jihad against this, but all Madahib, whenever this issue rose, they all spoke out against it, because all of us had a unanimous belief that the Quran is the speech of Allah and not the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So coming on to this now, Wal Quranu, and subhanAllah is mentioned very beautifully here by Imam Sahib, Wal Quranu kalamullahi ta'ala fil masahifi مكتوب وفي قلوب المحفوظ وعلى اللسان على اللسان مقروء وعلى النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام منزل. That the Quran is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First point. والقرآن كلام الله تعالى. It is the speech of Allah, the Most Highest. في المصاحف مكتوب. It is written in its scriptures. So the Quran is written in texts or scripture. وَفِي الْقُلُوبِ مَحْفُوظٌ, and in the hearts it is protected. In other words, mahfuz comes is the maf'ul of hafiz. Hafiz is the fa'il, hifz. The hafiz is someone who has what we call in common terms, someone who has memorized the Quran. But in literally, hafiz means someone who protects. Someone who protects, and that thing which is protected is called mahfuz. So Imam Sahib is saying here, wa mahfuzun, wa fil qulubi mahfuzun, and in the hearts it is protected. So meaning when somebody has memorized the Quran, he has protected the Quran. In what sense? Now by him protecting the Quran, that now the Quran cannot be changed. Because this is the difference between the Quran and other books, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this quality himself. He has this attribute, this quality of hafiz. وَنَحْنُ نَذَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّ لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. That we are the one who revealed this Quran, and I, Allah, am the protector of this Quran. And how? That those people of mine that I choose, that they will memorize and they will protect this Quran of mine in their hearts. And in this way the Quran cannot be changed. For example, somebody who memorized it, somebody who tries to change that or trigger anything in that, soon as that comes in the front of the person who has memorized it, he will realize straight away that this has been changed, it has been abrogated, this is wrong. So this is the difference between the Quran and previous texts, that some ulama have written the previous texts came in such big volumes, like the Bible and the Torah, so on and so forth, that they came in such large volumes that it was impossible for them to be memorized. Though some did, but on a large scale, it was not possible. Therefore, the Quran was sent as a summary of them books, and it is memorized. That's why Imam Sahib mentions that wa fil qulubi mahfuzun, that in the hearts it is mahfuz, protected. Wa alal al-suni makruun, and upon the tongues it is read. وَعَلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مُنَزَّلٌ, and upon the Prophet Muhammad it was revealed. So the Quran is a speech of Allah, and in the texts it is written, in the hearts it is protected, on the tongues it is read, and upon the Nabi it was revealed. So this is the Imam Sahib, the definition they have given of the Holy Quran, that, and it's a very beautiful definition as well. I had mentioned that wal Quran kalamullahi ta'ala fil masahifi makdubun wa fi qulubi mahfuzun wa ala al-ulsun al-makruun wa ala an-nabiy alayhi salatu wa salam munazzalun. وَلَفْظُنَا بِالْقُرْآنِ مَخْلُوقٌ وَكِتَابَتُنَا لَهُ مَخْلُوقَةٌ وَكِرَاءَتُنَا لَهُ مَخْلُوقَةٌ وَالْقُرْآنُ غَيْرُ مَخْلُوقٍ. That وَلَفْظُنَا بِالْقُرْآنِ مَخْلُوقٌ, that the words, our words of the Quran are created. So this is something you should write. So our uttering of the Quran, the words which we use here, which we read from, our uttering of the Quran is created. وَكِتَابَتُنَا لَهُ مَخْلُوقَةٌ, our writing of the Quran is created. So when we write the Quran, that is a creation. وَكِرَاءَتُنَا لَهُ مَخْلُوقَةٌ, our reciting of the Quran is created. وَالْقُرْآنُ غَيْرُ مَخْلُوقٍ, but the Quran itself is not created. So how that, when we read the Quran, when we read it, the uttering of the Quran, that is a creation. Because why? We are a creation of Allah, our words, what we use is a creation. When we write it, the Quran is written and scripted all across the world, that's a creation. The book is the creation. This, but the Quran itself, that's not a creation of Allah. That's not a creation, but that is the Kalamullah Ta'ala. That is the speech of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Further on.
Our utterance is created.
Yep.
The book's form is created.
No, yeah, the written. So our utterance, yeah, our writing, our reciting. So these things. وَلَفْضُنَا وَكِتَابُتُنَا وَكِرَاءَتُنَا مَخْلُوق وَالْقُرْآنُ غَيْرُ مَخْلُوق, but the Quran is not created.
What's the difference between the utterance?
So one is when we recite the Quran, as in the sense, for example, we say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, recitation of the Quran. When we say the words Alhamdulillah, generally we're talking about the Quran, that's different, it's utterance, it's the words itself. Because the lafz is a word, but what lafz is used is utter, something which is uttered from a person's mouth is called a lafz. So the words of the Quran itself, when we say the words here, we see a word, one word of the Quran, as we see it, write it, or speak it, or recite it, that is a creation. The Quran itself is not the creation of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala.
وَمَا ذَكَرَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فِي الْقُرْآنِ حِكَايَةً عَنْ مُوسَى وَغَيْرِهِ مِنَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّلَامُ وَعَنْ فِرْعَوْنَ وَإِبْلِيسِ فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ كُلَّهُ كَلَامُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى إِخْبَارًا عَنْهُمْ. That wherever Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala in the Quran has said, where He has quoted Musa alayhi salam, or Isa alayhi salam, or other prophets, Allah in the Quran says, وَقَالَ إِسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمْ, Isa, the son of Maryam, said that indeed I am the Rasul of Allah, indeed I am the Prophet of Allah. Then وَقَالَ مُوسَى, Musa said, so and so forth. Iblis said, so and so forth. This is said, so and so forth. So now Allah is quoting somebody else. Though Allah has quoted them, but what is in the Quran has said, whatever Allah has quoted, that is still the speech of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So what Musa said is a creation, what Iblis said was a creation, what Fir'aun said was a creation, what Musa said was a creation, but when Allah narrated and quoted that from His own speech, that is not a creation. That's the differentiation between the two. So again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is narrating that to us, that obviously for whatever reasons there may be, obviously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that this, the final Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, final Nabi of mine will come, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and these narrations which I am giving in relation to Musa or Isa or Yaqub or Yunus or Yusuf alayhi salam, that these will benefit the Ummah of my final Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, and this will be a form of guidance for them. So this is why these were narrated. So when Musa alayhi salam in actual said that, so Musa, Isa alayhi salam did actually say that I am the Rasul of Allah. Musa alayhi salam did say that Allah, I want to see you. Iblis did say that I will not bow down to something which has been created from mud. The angels did say that Allah, don't create a man because they will bring fasad on earth. So this creations of Allah, they did say these things.
what they said, that was a creation at that time, because it was their own words, it was their own speech which was created, their speech was created as well. But when Allah quoted that in the Quran, that became the speech of Allah, which is uncreated. That's a differentiation between the speech of Allah when He narrates from His creation, and when what He narrates, that was created. But when He narrates it Himself, that becomes uncreated. That becomes the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that, again, you need to differentiate between the two, that how the Allah's own speech and when He narrates, that also is regarded as the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, because the Quran is a speech of Allah, so again, speech is an attribute of Allah. Now, every attribute of Allah, Allah was the possessor of that attribute, always was, is, and forever will be. So this speech of Allah, which was the Quran, was an attribute which was from pre-eternity. Whereas the speech of His creation was created and not from pre-eternity. So that again, clarifies and distinguishes between Allah's own speech, which is uncreated, and the speech of His creation, which is created. So again, here Imam Sahib is mentioning that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa alayhi salam, and the Quran mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa. Allah did speak to Musa, and indeed Musa heard Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well, and he spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. But again, Allah's speech was uncreated, Musa alayhi salam's speech was created. So just mention right now again, because Musa alayhi salam was famously known for Kalimullah, the one who spoke to Allah. But the difference is that Musa alayhi salam's speech was created, whereas Allah's speech to Musa, that was uncreated. So again, now back to the other attributes again, which Imam Sahib is mentioning here, that about the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that wa sifatuhu kulluha bi khilafi sifatil makhluqin, that every attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not similar to the attributes of His creation. Like here, wa ya'lamu la ka ilmina wa yaqdiru la ka qudratina wa yara la ka ru'yatina. So meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew when there was nothing there to be known. He was the powerful of over everything. When there was nothing there, He was still the all-powerful. He saw when there was nothing to be seen. He spoke before there was anything to be spoken to. He heard before there was anything to be heard. And what we believe is, in simple, that every وَنَحْنُ نَتَكَلَّمُ بِالْآلَاتِ وَالْحُرُوفِ وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَى يَتَكَلَّمُ بِلَا آلَةٍ وَلَا حُرُوفٍ وَالْحُرُوفُ مَخْلُوقَةٌ وَكَلَامُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى غَيْرُ مَخْلُوقٍ. That the huruf, the letters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we use these huruf, these letters we use for us to picture, to form the Quran. Alif, ba, ta, tha, we put this together, make a language. Answers your question again, that then we understand the Quran. So the hurufs, the letters of the Quran are created, but the Quran itself is not created. So the hurufs, they are created, but the Quran is uncreated. And like we use certain organs, ways, what they call Allah, certain ways of speaking. So for example, for me to communicate to you, I need a way, a method, that is a language. And then a language needs a method to be formed, that is letters, alphabets, grammar, text, so on and so forth. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not need that. So therefore these hurufs, these languages, these so on and so forth, these are all a creation, but the Quran itself is not a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a very simple belief in relation to that. And that's what all of our a'imma have unanimously agreed upon. And anybody who disregards that, anybody who believes that the Quran is a creation of Allah, he becomes a disbeliever. So make a note of that as well, that anybody who believes otherwise, he becomes a disbeliever.
Mu'tazila, do we consider them disbelievers?
Yeah, those that we do, yeah, because not only them, but the other sects, the Qadriya, the Jahmiya, many have these different beliefs in relation to the Quran. So anybody who believes that, because the one is that you are denying an attribute of Allah, because our core belief is that speech is an attribute of Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was always the possessor of that attribute, and anything of Allah's attribute cannot be compared to His creation. So the Quran was not a creation, because if the Quran was a creation, that means that Allah's speech is a creation. Whereas Allah's speech is uncreated, so that's where the core difference comes. Now if the Quran is a creation, and we believe the Quran is the Kalamullah, it is the speech of Allah. So if the Quran is created, then that means Allah's speech is created. Then if Allah's speech, which is one of Allah's attributes, if that is created, then that brings a flow to Allah Almighty. Because Allah was the possessor of that attribute of speech, even before there was anything to be spoken to. Allah was a possessor. So therefore, that cannot be the correct belief about anybody, and anybody who does have that belief, it becomes an act of following Islam.
But just to, you know, the physical attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does that fall in any of in essentials or the active attributes?
No, obviously now, for example, now, are we, the physical part, for example, now, that, like I mentioned this point now, earlier, that for us to speak, we need to use a means.
Yeah.
Language, letters, so on and so forth, yeah, mouth to speak from, whatever, yeah, you need ears to hear. For us to make something, we need a hands to make that. Whereas for Allah to create anything, He is not restricted or needed for Him to rely upon anything. So how the physical attributes of Allah, when we say hand, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not need this hand for Him to create something. Allah did not need ears to hear something. Allah did not need eyes to see something. Allah did not need a mouth to speak. So these physical attributes of Allah prove from here again that they are used in the metaphorical way for us to understand. Because if they were compared to us, then it would say that that means that Allah would need a hand to create. Allah would need eyes to see. Allah would need ears to hear. Allah would need a nose to smell. Allah would need a chair to sit on. Like what they believe that Allah has created the throne for Himself to sit on. And He has made the throne just right to His size. So that means you're restricting Allah to a size. If you restrict Allah to a size, then you're restricting Him to left, right, up, down, back, forward.
You know what you just said, we speak to a brother and he goes, the way Allah's sitting and everything is the way Allah befits. So, is that...
No, when we say Allah is sitting, does Allah sit? So now you're basically...
They got that from the Quran, so
Allah is established over the throne or something.
No, that's called istiwa. The istiwa al-arsh, that's different to sitting. Because again, when we say istiwa, what they think of istiwa is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He divided Himself away from His creation. The all my creation is here, and He went above His arsh. And underneath the arsh was His creation, He leaves them to what they want to do. And Allah Himself, He sat on top of His arsh, on His throne, and that's where He is. From there He sees everything. That's what they believe. Now istiwa, the meaning which we take, is completely different to that. Because what we're saying is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is everywhere in His knowledge, in His power. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to say that He created everything and then He had to find a place to go and sit, which was on the arsh. Before the arsh was there, before this throne was there, where was Allah then? So if you're going to put Allah befitting Him somewhere, you're going to think befitting. So fitting again, it fits into something in it. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be fitted to anything, because He has no dimensions, He has no size, it is out of our understanding. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs something to be fitted into, when nothing was there to be fitted into, when the throne was not there, when the arsh was not there, when the creation was not there, when all this was not there, where was Allah at that time? Where did Allah stay for so long? Did He have a chair then? So does that mean the chair was created before the pen? Before other things? Did Allah's mother need a throne for Him to sit on? Did He need a stool to put His feet on? This is exactly when it comes back to the point that what we say is from these meanings that Allah's mother is giving a metaphorical meaning to us, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Ta'ala, He is the most highest. Now again, highest can mean two meanings. One is high as in height. High, if I say He is higher than Him, we say Your Royal Highness. What do you mean by that? Not highness as she's higher than us, she's standing somewhere higher than us. She could be the queen, when she's standing on the same level as us, we still say Your Highness. What does it mean by that? Not that she's standing higher than us, or she's sitting on a higher place than us, or she's sitting up in her palace and we're standing there, then we say Your Highness. It means no, in status she's higher than us. In her power, in her rank, she's higher than us. When we say Allah Ta'ala, Allah the highest, the Almighty, Ta'ala, Allah, the highest, means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in power, in control, in creation, in sustenance, He is the highest. There is nothing higher than Him. No way, in no form. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highest in all His creation. He's the creator of His creation, He's the highest of all of His. He is higher than all His creation. That's what the meaning is. Not the sense that Allah is highest, the sense that He's gone to that point where nothing else has gone past and He's sitting there looking at us. Because then you are putting Allah into a place. Arsh is a creation. Yeah? La Makan is the kursi, the arsh, the stool, the throne. These are all creations. If you put Allah there, then you are limitizing Him to His own creation. Then you are limitizing Allah to His own creation. When Allah cannot be limited to His own creation, there is no limit to Allah. So we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His power and in His knowledge is everywhere. Other than that, all we know is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the all-seeing, He is the all-hearing. We concentrate on His attributes more than where Allah is, how He is, what He looks like. This is not for us to dwell into. Because when our own aql, our aql is created, right? Our logic, our intellect is all created. If this logic and intellect which is created by Allah, if this manages to comprehend Allah, then that means that that's not Allah then. When its own creation can comprehend Him. So why try to? When you know your intellect and aql cannot reach there, so why you try to go into detail that Allah is sitting here, He's like this, He's like this. That's not should be the right. Yeah.
Do you know when Salafis, they ask you, where is Allah Ta'ala? And then you say, oh, this is not a question you should ask. They respond and they say that, you know, they quote Imam Abu Hanifa, and I think it's a quote taken out of context, because Imam Abu Hanifa apparently said that you have to know where Allah Ta'ala is. Do you know the context of that story?
The fact that Imam Sahib said that you have to know where Allah is, that, so. What it means, out of context, is when Imam Sahib has mentioned this, that when we say, for example, we say that Allah is, for example, if I say that a hide is. What does that mean?
It exists.
Where it exists, that's something else. Hide is, that means it exists. So Imam Sahib saying is that you should know where Allah is. That Allah is means that those people who believe that Allah is non-existent, that can't be the case. You have to believe that Allah is, that Allah exists. That Allah exists, that's why Allah is. Allah is that Allah exists. Where Allah is, how Allah is, in what way Allah is, that's not for us to know. All we need to know is that what Allah has explained to us, in the sense that what His attributes are, what His essential attributes, what His active attributes are, that's what we must believe in. We must follow that, we must accept that. But then to dwell into these issues, that how and why, and so on and so forth, then you are...
Just another question similar to that one, is that, do you know when we say, for example, there's like, you got fiqh Muslim, you know, that kind of issue, and they say, you know, we've got the scholars for that, there's some people who say this, that we have the scholars for all these fiqh stuff, but Aqida is Allah's made it very, and I think, I don't know the Arabic quote of the Quran, they say that Allah's made the deen very simple to understand. So Aqida, you know, you don't need scholars for that. This is the brother said to that to me. But Aqida is very simple. You don't really need an explanation for it. So okay. What do you have to say?
So if he says that, then he seems to be very uneducated, because the simple thing to that is that if there's no need for that, then if you read Hadith of Jibreel, this is Jibreel alayhi salam, the narrative by Umar رضي الله تعالى عنه, Sahih Muslim, that where a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was unknown, a stranger, and he came and he sat next to the Prophet and he asked them three questions. Akhbirni anil Islam. inform me what is Islam. And the Prophet replied and said, what is Islam? Islam is to believe in Allah and me as his messenger, to perform namaz, to give zakat, to fast in Ramadan, and to do hajj. That's Islam. So now, that should be the religion. If you believe in Allah and his Prophet, then we pray our namaz, then we need to know how to pray our namaz, that's fiqh. How to give zakat, that's fiqh. How to fast, that's fiqh. How to do hajj, that's fiqh. What's right to do, what's wrong to do, what's makruh, what's fard, was farz ain, was farz kifaya, was wajib, was makruh tanzihi, was makruh tahrimi, was sunnat muakida, was sunnat ghair muakida, was sunnat zaida, was sunnat huda, was mustahab, was mubah, was haram. All these things will be enough then. Then the next question he asked you, akhbirni an al-iman, tell me what is iman. And the Prophet said again, tu'minu billah, to believe in Allah, wa rasulihi, and his rasuls, wa malaikatihi, wa kutubi, wa rasulihi, وَالْبَاثِ بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ and so on and so forth. This point which we are mentioning now, that you must believe in Allah, all his Rasul, all his angels, all his books, so on and so forth. Then he said, أَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِحْسَانِ. Ask me, tell me what is Ihsan. Then the Prophet, Ihsan is to worship Allah as if you can see Allah. And if you cannot see Allah, to believe that Allah can see you. These three questions that were asked. The ulama have said that the scholars who have taken the burden to teach us about the first part of this hadith, how to pray zakat, how to pay, how to give sadaqah, how to fast, how to do hajj, how to do namaz, are the fuqaha, the faqih, those who taught us fiqh. Then the second part, to believe in Allah, how should we believe in Allah? How should we believe in His messengers? How should we believe in His angels? What should we believe about them? In what sense should we believe about them? For this, the responsibility who took this were the mutakallimeen. The mutakallimeen are the ulama of kalam, the ulama of aqaid. They took off this burden to explain to us our aqida. And if this was not necessary, if this was not necessary, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wouldn't, our ulama that came before us, why would Imam Abu Hanifa be sent to prison over these issues? Why was Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal whipped and stoned nearly to death in the streets over this issue? Why was Imam Bukhari nearly sentenced to death, that he, in the end he asked Allah himself, Ya Allah, take my life away, over these issues of Aqidah? Why did our scholars go into so much, why was the Imam Abu Hassan Ash'ari, Imam Abu Mansur Maturidi, why did they become imprisoned? If there's no need for Aqidah, if there's no need to explain our belief to us, then why in the Quran has Allah said, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu wa amilu salihat, O you who believe and do good actions. Wherever actions has come, first Allah says, O you who believe and do actions, meaning if your belief is correct first, then your actions which are good will be accepted. So if you want to develop into actions so much, first you must get your belief right in order for them actions to be accepted. Therefore, fiqh are these issues and learning about these come after. In order for that to be accepted, first you must correct your iman, correct your belief, correct your aqidah. And that's what Allah has emphasized in the Quran and mentioned it even before He has mentioned about good actions. That's why our scholars for 1400 years, every person who has begun anything to teach, they always begin by teaching Aqidah first, our beliefs of Aqaid, teaching us about our Aqaid. The Quran has come to us to teach us our Aqaid, to teach us our belief, our Iman. Iman is the first thing. Iman is our Aqidah is our Iman. Iman is the word for that. Because why? When you believe what the Imam Sahib said, the first word he said, Amantu. Amantu is what the siga mutakallim, I believe. Amana, amana, amantu, 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 I believe. So your aqidah is in relation to your belief. So how can belief be made such a small issue? How can belief be made a second or third issue? When belief is your first issue, first point, and a person, we say of ulama written in the hadith as well, that a person in his life, he may not have done no good actions. But if his iman is correct, based upon that, one day he will be given paradise, surely. But if his all his life his iman has been wrong, his aqidah has been wrong, but his actions have been good, that has no resemblance, that has no significance. The ultimate point for us is our aqidah, is our belief, is our iman. And to do islah of our iman, and as Uzul Shaykh Mujaddid Al-Fithani Rahimahullah Ta'ala, who is a great imam, they mentioned in their Maktubat Sharif about this Agar Al-Ayazam Billah, Dar Yak Masala, az masaile ضروریاتی اعتقاد یا خلل رفت بس دولت نجات اخروی محرومند بس عمدہ قار تصحیح عقائد است بروف قارا صاحب اہل سنت والجماعت کے فرقہ ناجیان. In Farsi, they mention this point in Maktubah Sharif that agar al-ayazam billah, for instance, if a person, dar yak masala, if one masala, one issue, az masail-e zuriyati etikadiya khalal raf, that amongst the necessity beliefs of religion, if one masala of his was to be short, if he was to fall short in believing in one issue of all the necessity issues of belief, then what will happen? Bas dolat-e najat-e ukhrawi mahrumand, then he will not receive the freedom from the hellfire. If one issue of the masail of zuriyat-e deen, if he was to fall short in even one, he would not be able to receive the freedom from the fire of hell. Therefore, bas umda qar, the best thing you can do is tasheeh-e aqaid ast, to do islah, to better and learn about your aqaid. Barwafqara sahib ahl sunnah wal jamaat. Therefore, if you want to make your aqeedah correct and make your aqeedah according to those who will be given freedom from the hellfire, then go and learn from the ulama of the ahl sunnah wal jamaat. Firqa najiyan, because that is the firqa, that is the group that Allah will free from the hellfire. So our ulama have stressed so much in the relation to aqeedah and in relation to our belief, as somebody who says it is simple, that person who says it is simple for him, then if you ask him a few questions alone, just ask him the first five attributes that I've told you, what we should believe in Allah, and I guarantee you'll be able to answer the first five. You don't have to mention three. Only say Allah, and you won't even know what the between the difference between fail and zat, what the faili attributes are, what the zati attributes are. These are very far for them. Because why? Because they know if they develop into aqidah, the whole aqidah becomes flaws. Why? Because they themselves have believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got a physical body, when they believe Allah is limited to certain things, when Allah is bound by dimensions, when they believe Allah is sitting at certain places, Allah has a chair, Allah has a place, Allah has a roof, so on and so forth. They know as soon as they go and open the first page of any Aqidah book for the last 1400 years, they'll be made kafir according to that issue. They'll be at the front of Islam on the first page of any Aqidah book. Very simple. That's what they say, you don't need to go into Aqidah. Leave Aqidah to others. Leave it with us. Because they know if they open up the Imam Bajuri's Risala of Tawheed, first people to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mukhalaf alil hawadis. He cannot be compared to anything in his creation. And someone who doesn't believe that, mushrik. So on the first page of any Aqidah book, they'll be at the fall of Islam. That's why they don't want to go into Aqidah. Only Alhamdulillah, only the Ahl Sunnah can go and dwell into Aqidah books, because the Aqidah of the Ahl Sunnah complies with every Aqidah book for the last 1400 years. That's why. We are the ones who teach Aqidah first, unlike them. They won't do that. They go and grab a person, they say there's a person, there's a way of killing somebody in two ways. You either kill him instantly, or you kill him softly. They softly kill people. They say, you know, brother, you're in the nightclub, let's come, let me take you to the masjid. You should do this, you should avoid that, you should avoid this, you should avoid that. Taking him with the actions. Then what they do, then they poison him. Slowly, 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 eventually they poison his whole iman. But Alhamdulillah, the Sunni is very clear. When you see someone for the first time, what do you say? Tell me this. You say, Ya Rasulullah. If you do, then come see me, then I'll explain to you what deen is. So that teach you what deen is. Very clear. So that should be our way. Though we should do islah of amal as well. Actions is necessary as well. But first thing you must tell a person is, when you get hold of them, you at the same time you tell them, read namaz, give zakat, do hajj. These are very important as well. But Allah has all you who believe and do good actions. Belief is first. Rectify their belief as well. Tell them that the Lord we believe in is not that Lord that people say has a physical hand and physical feet and a physical body, and that Lord that sits on a chair and has his feet on a stool is not that Lord. But our Lord is that Lord that he is not comparable to anything in his creation.
You know what they say regarding the physicality, what they say? Is that definitely written in the books?
That's Ibn Taymiyyah's Majmu' al-Fatawa.
The brother that we talk to, he goes, we don't mean it. What Allah's feet hands are is the way Allah befits, the way Allah knows best.
So, no, but that's what he's saying, because now they're going to answer that. Because if you read Ibn Taymiyyah's works, Majmu' al-Fatawa, Al-Aqida al-Wasatiyya, Al-Aqida al-Jalila fi Tawassuli wal-Wasila, and these books, very clearly Ibn Taymiyyah has said that Allah has made a throne which is for him to sit on, which befits his size, exactly, perfect.
So the brother was lying then to us.
So the brother who's told you, obviously he's not read his own Aqidah books, has he? That's why he says don't read Aqidah.
Yeah, he says we get
Aqidah
straight from the Quran, Surah
Ikhlas. That's Surah Ikhlas, then yeah, if you go to Surah Ikhlas, fine, do that. But Surah Ikhlas says, there is nothing like Allah. So that's, if you stick to Surah Ikhlas, you'll be fine. But at least stick to Surah Ikhlas then. Stick to Surah Ikhlas, don't go anywhere else then. Stick to Surah Ikhlas. Because if you say that you stick to Surah Ikhlas, then believe in the last ayah of Surah Ikhlas as well. وَلَمْ يَقُلْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدٌ. There is nothing like Allah. So there's no part of a person's creation, a body, is like Allah's. You can't use that. So therefore you should need to look at that issue. And when it comes to the Prophet ﷺ, when we say the Prophet ﷺ has a knowledge of the unseen, you quickly say, oh shirk, shirk, shirk. Allah has a knowledge of unseen. How can the Prophet has a knowledge of unseen as well? That's kufr, that's shirk. But when it comes to Allah's physical body, you say, yeah, he's got a physical body, we have as well. Then you don't want to go into anything else. As only Aqidah only comes into when, if that's the case, then no Wahhabi, no Salafi from today on should ever speak to anybody or stop a person from doing Mawlid, stop a person from saying Ya Rasulullah, stop a person believing the Prophet has knowledge of the unseen, stop a person from doing Khatam, stop a person from believing that the Prophet is Hazil and Nazil, to stop a person from believing the Prophet is Mukhtarikun, because why? These are all issues of Aqaid. So if Aqidah is not important and only actions matter, then why talk about these issues? Why do your sheikhs from Saudi Arabia get paid millions and billions of dollars and petrol money that you give that you get from Americans? You take money from them, and with that money you infest Wahhabi beliefs into your Maulvis, and with that same petrol you give the Americans, they put that in their tanks and go and kill people in Palestine. They go and kill Muslims in Afghanistan. They go and kill Muslims in Iraq. And if the Saudi regime was to take out their investments from America, overnight the American economy would collapse. Why don't they? But yet they don't want to even open up borders for Palestinian Muslims. So you want to follow them people. That's the people they want to follow. So that's what they want. That's right. That's fine. That's fine. To go and destroy the dome of the Prophet ﷺ, according to them, that's fine as well. But to speak about the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to speak about Aqidah, that's too important for us to speak about. That's not necessary. So these people need to read their own books of Aqidah. Go read what Ibn Baz had to say, what Albani had to say, and what Ibn Taymiyyah had to say. Before Ibn Taymiyyah, they can't go. But according to them, anyone who came before Ibn Taymiyyah and after him, who was wrong against them, like Allama Ibn Abidin Shami mentioned in Fatawa Shami, that when the Wahhabi regime came up for the first time, the belief was what? That anybody who did not believe the way we believed, he was a mushrik. And they believed that it was allowed to kill anybody who did not have the same belief as them.
Who is that man?
Allama Ibn Abidin Shami, wrote Fatawa Shami, who is a judicial, massive authority in Islam. Allama Ibn Abidin Shami, massive authority in Islam and in the Hanafi madhab, massive authority. And amongst the Ahlul Sunnah, one of the main fatawas which we use, which has got even higher rank than the fatawa of Imam Ahmad Raza Khan, Fatawa Shami, Fatawa Qazi Khan, these fatawas, Fatawa Alamgiri, these rank of fatawas, Allama Ibn Abidin Shami goes, I was an eyewitness to their regime. When they came up, they go, we are Hanbali. They go, we are Hanbali, we are Mukallid to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Yet, the way of Islam was against the teachings of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He writes this. And then what happened? And if you remember the talk I did in Hyde a few years ago, when the Murtaza Khan and the Mishki, on that issue, I mentioned this point there as well, that should be in the video as well. I read the Ibarat from Allama ibn Abdi Shami's fatawa. They mentioned that they made it allowed to kill the women and the ulama of the Ahl Sunnah. It was allowed to rape the women of the Ahl Sunnah and to kill the ulama of the Ahl Sunnah. Because why? Anybody who did not have the same belief as them, they were mushrik. This was their belief. So if Aqidah was not the point, if Aqidah was not so important, then what did the Wahhabi movement come into being for? Was over this issue. They got their beliefs are wrong. The Aqidah is wrong. They are mushriks. They are so on and so forth. And upon that issue they came and they wanted to overtake. It was on that issue. What is it today, the biggest issue? When you go to Masjid al-Haram or Masjid al-Nabawi, you can do Rafaya then and read. If you don't do Rafaya then, nobody will stop you from not doing Rafaya then. And nobody will stop you from doing Rafaya then. But as soon as you go and stand and Islam in front of the Rozam Barakat the Prophet, they'll come and push you outside. So if Aqidah is not the issue, what are they doing there? What double standards are these? So Aqidah is the main issue, but when they get snookered, then Aqidah becomes second issue. And Alhamdulillah, on every issue that they bring up, they have been snookered. And they will stay snookered. There's no way for them to get out of it. There's no way, it's such a snooker that there's no way to get out. The only way they can get out is accept that what we've done is wrong, and we want to come and learn and abide our lives and our beliefs according to the way of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat. That's the only way. There's no other way around it. The Ahlul Sunnah, only the Ahlul Sunnah, their Aqidah is right, nothing else. There's no second place, there's no second point. Alhamdulillah, our Aqidah works starts from the Quran, Sunnah, from Imam Abu Hanifa, which is the first book written on Aqidah. Tells one Wahhabi who wrote a book on Aqidah before Ibn Taymiyyah. Before Ibn Baz al-Albani, who wrote a book on Aqidah. Alhamdulillah, we can say 1400 years ago, our Imams wrote books on Aqidah. Because our Aqidah did not start after, they started from then. They can bring me one Wahhabi, Salafi person, who can say that in the first century of Islam, when Imam Sahib wrote this book on Aqidah, that they have got someone at that time who wrote a book on Aqidah. From the 2nd century, 3rd century, 4th century, 5th century, bring one person who wrote a book on Aqidah. They ain't got no one who wrote a book on Aqidah. Because that Aqidah did not exist. Only when it came into existence, then they wrote on it. And that was not from the time of the Aslaf. That was not in the time of the Aslaf. The Aslaf are those, the first three generations. The Sahaba, the Tabi'een, and Taba Tabi'een. Which one of them is from that? Which one of the Tabi'een, Taba Tabi'een, and the Sahaba Ikram had the same belief as them? Which one had the same belief as them? None of them had the same belief as them. The Sahaba Ikram were those that they did not even think twice. But when the Kuffar sent a spy to the army of the Muslims, he goes, go and see what the people do there and come back, tell us. When you come back, tell us, because he follows you, don't go to war with them. He goes, don't make Muhammad as your enemy. Why? He goes, because I've never seen somebody respected so much that when he spits, the Sahaba used to jump to collect the spit and rub it over their faces as a form of cure. That when the hair of the Prophet used to be cut, that they should run and jump and take the hair of the Prophet and use that as a form of protection. You want to go to war with that person? Think twice. That's the Sahaba Ikram were. Muhammad bin Usman bin Hunayf, the hadith which comes in the Sunnah of Ibn Majah, that when the Prophet ﷺ, and also mentioned Dalal al-Nabuwa by Imam Bihaki, that when the Prophet ﷺ was sitting in a gathering with his companions, and a man came and he said, Ya Rasulullah, he goes, I'm blind. Do dua to Allah, my eyesight comes back. If he was like the belief of today, he would say, I'll ask Allah alone, why go to the Prophet ﷺ for wasila? Then he went and the Prophet ﷺ said, okay, go, do wudu, read two rakat namaz nafal, and in your dua say, Ya Allah, do tawajjuh upon me, look at me, concentrate on me with the wasila of your beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This dua was done. The Sahaba Ikram write, Imam Bihaki writes that we were still sitting in the gathering of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That companion went blind, and when he returned from two nafal, he came back with his eyesight back. This was wasila the Sahaba Ikram reading, and they saying that we follow that group of time of people. We follow that generation, the Tabi'een. What is Imam Azam Hanifa? What's his belief? What was the belief of Imam Azam Hanifa? What we are teaching now, they bring me one book of theirs that complies with the teaching of Imam Abu Hanifa. All the Aqidah is against the Aqidah of Imam Abu Hanifa. Imam Abu Hanifa, all the points which they have mentioned is a dagger in their heart. That's why they don't like Imam Abu Hanifa, because their Aqidah is against the Aqidah of Imam Abu Hanifa. This is our Imam. We are the real people who follow the Aslaf. Salafi is mansub towards the Aslaf. We are the real people who follow the Aslaf. These are called the pseudo Salafis. Mad people. They're not Salafis, they're mad people. And as more than Salafis, they should be called something else. Khalafi or something like this, we don't follow Salaf. They don't follow the Salaf. Their Salaf only is restricted to the last 100 years. Nothing past that. So Alhamdulillah, our belief for the last 1400 years has been pen by pen the same. Has been no differences in our belief, has never been difference in our Aqidah. Our ulama have stressed that make your Aqidah correct. When your Aqidah becomes correct, Allah will accept your actions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if there's any more questions, yeah.
So this brother, obviously, he either didn't know or he hasn't read his book. So how would you approach him? What would you say to him?
Firstly, I think this brother, whoever he is, if he's educated, which I don't think he seems to be educated from the questions he's asking.
Invite him to the class.
Yeah, I think you invite him here if he wants to come. But then again, for him, obviously, Aqidah classes are not very important. So maybe after the Aqidah classes, if he wants to come and see me, then he can come and sit down then. But the questions he's asking, these don't seem very a question of any intellectual person or any person who is educated, because I'm sure to have our correct belief in Allah and His Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this is what determines a person to be a Muslim or not. So I advise him to first try and study his own books of Aqidah, what his scholars have written, and their imams. Can't say imam because they don't really have an imam, because they don't believe in an imam like we believe in the four imams. They said these are not imams, but to believe in their predecessors, their own predecessors, see what they had to write about Aqidah, and then try to compare that with the teachings of the Ahlul Sunnah and the teachings of the Quran and Hadith, and see if that complies together. Then after that, if he needs to, then he can come and see me as well. He's most welcome anytime, alhamdulillah. And not only him, any person who has any doubts or any sort of frailties in his Iman and Aqidah, I'm sure we should try, and we will try inshallah, to make do islah of that and make that better and make it in accordance with the belief of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our coming here today, and may He give us all the ability to keep our Aqidah in accordance with the teaching of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat. Wa ma'alina illa al-balagh wal-mubin.